B-Pod Studios.
Now it's time for Zolak and Bertrand. Brought to you by BetMGM, the king of sportsbooks, on the Sports Hub.
Yeah, I just felt really good about us converting and getting our momentum and not letting them play long ball. You know, they were bleeding the clock out. That's what they do. And I wanted to get the upper hand back, you know, and it's easy hindsight, and I get it, you know. I get that. But I don't regret those decisions, and that's hard. You know, it's hard because, you know, we didn't come through. It wasn't able to work out, but I don't. And I understand the scrutiny I'll get. That's part of the gig, man. But, you know, we just didn't work out.
That's Dan Campbell.
Inexperienced Dan Campbell.
Head coach.
Not understanding the moment.
Head coach of the Detroit Lions, who went on the road for the NFC title game. The Detroit Lions, who went to the locker room at halftime yesterday, up 24-7.
Oh, waving bye to the crowd.
And the Detroit Lions, who lost 34-31 and are going home after what was a great season for them, no doubt. A season that was better than any season Lions fans, for the most part, have experienced in their lifetime. And that's all fine and good. And obviously it was exciting along the way. But if you're a Lions fan,
you may never get back.
Or you're a Lions player today, how can you not feel like you should have found a way to win that game and be in the Super Bowl? I don't know. He had to overrule
the analytics in that spot.
It's like, got to feel like grief today.
They must
be grieving today, this loss.
Look at the sideline. Look at the shock they had on their face.
What a gut punch.
And, okay, we're an analytical team. We've gone for it a lot. As you advance, the games get different. You can't treat Week 7 the same as the NFC title game. You're on the road. You're there. You had the upper hand. You could feel it getting away from you. You got the opportunity to kick the field goal to tie it. You take the points.
So there is a time to be bold, and there is a time.
He didn't feel the game. He didn't feel it in his gut. He didn't feel the momentum swinging. He didn't feel my players are becoming unraveled. Drops, fumbles. Now, I would say that the fumble flipped the game more so than him not kicking the field goal and going for it.
And multiple field goals.
Yeah.
Not one field goal. It's actually on three different occasions in this game. He screwed it up. They've been aggressive all year long. They've been aggressive because Dan Campbell is their head coach. They're in this game against the 49ers yesterday because their head coach is Dan Campbell. So I understand why he could say, I don't have regrets. We got all the way to the NFC title game. The truth is, if he was more flexible, then he would be in the Super Bowl and he'd be going to Vegas. If he had a read on the situation and on the guys that he is coaching, he would have seen that it was coming unraveled. At 24-10, he could have had a field goal of 46 yards on a 4th-and-2. That would have put him up 3 scores in the game.
Yeah.
They went for it. It didn't work out. The Niners stopped them. Soon thereafter, it's 24-17. And at that point, if it hasn't smacked you in the face yet, you've got to say, oh, bleep. And that's not to say you got to tighten up. That's just to say you've got to be smart here. You have to take every point you can get. You are now fending these guys off.
Analytically, it's 3 possessions.
Then they're down. They're trailing 27-24, and this is what you're talking about, 7+ minutes to go in the game.
Yeah.
It would have been a 48-yard try at that point.
Kick there.
What does he do? Goes for it again. 49ers stop them again. And then all of a sudden, what was a 3-point game soon became a 10-point game. And even then, there is questionable decision-making down 10 points at the end. And Greg Olsen, to his credit, brought it up on the Fox broadcast. You're down in the red zone. You've got all 3 timeouts intact. You've got about a minute to go, minute plus, just over a minute in the game. You can kick the field goal and make it a 1-score game and keep your timeouts in your pocket and have all 3 of them and have an opportunity without recovering an onside kick to force a punt and get the ball back, and they couldn't do it because they didn't have the timeouts.
And they ran the ball
because
down
he used them.
He had to burn one running the ball.
And yes, they got a touchdown, and yes, it becomes a 3-point game, but at that point, it's really about how many times can you score. It's not about how many points you can get on the possession.
What would have been laughable.
And he didn't realize that.
No. And what would have been laughable is if they didn't get in on that third down on the touchdown catch. If it went to fourth down, would he have kicked a field goal or would he have gone for it? He probably would have gone for it.
And here's the other part. In the first half, at the end of the first half,
field goal.
He kicked the field goal.
Take the points.
He took the points.
Because it goes to three possessions.
His decision-making in this game did not even align from the end of the first half to what he started to do in the second half. He became unraveled just like his players. It's unfortunate because they were an easy team to root for, and I find him to be really likable, and I like that there are guys that do it a different way, and they're not all the same, and his players love him and want to play their ass off for him, and that's a nice thing to see. And God, were we all rooting for Detroit and for their fans to have something good. And I certainly am not rooting for any Shanahan.
Did you guys text Hardy?
Yuck, I did. Once. I was texting him in the first half.
I didn't
text him once in the second half. I texted him when the game was over, and I said, I'm sorry.
I texted him.
This is terrible for you.
I texted
him
the
sorry.
Emoji of the round face with just two eyes when the fumble happened. And I'm like, uh-oh.
So
and the drops. Oh, yeah. My God, the drops. You could tell.
Can I defend Dan Campbell for a second?
Yeah. Sure. What do you got?
How about Reynolds catches the ball on fourth down? The ball was in his hands. You're right. It unraveled. We all agree
it
unraveled.
Which fourth down?
The first fourth down that they went for when they were up 17 points.
Oh.
Catch the damn ball.
Yeah, there were a lot of those.
It was in his hands.
Yeah.
So we're crapping on, and everything went a disaster after that, right? They got the field goal. The fourth down happened. They didn't get it. The ball goes off the guy's face mask, and Ayuk catches it. Then it all
they get every bounce.
But the Lions became the Lions.
Yeah.
We all watched it. The history of the Lions
I knew it.
Showed up in the game.
I said, I'm like, let's not be crazy.
No, they saw ghosts, bro.
Remember, I go, the Lions could be in the Super Bowl. Let's not get crazy now.
Hardy knew it too.
The Lions just became the Lions.
At the end of the year in a Dan Skipper call with the two-pointer net, he goes, I'm not going to be this mad about this game because I know what's going to happen in the playoffs.
They're going to turn back into the Lions.
Yeah.
They did not restore the roar.
I mean, I feel bad for like the people at that stadium that went to Ford Field and painted their faces. Like, this is your time. This is your moment. And you got Charlie Brown, man. They pulled the ball out.
But real quick, I think you agree. They probably should have gone for the field goal on the fourth down that I talked about the drop to go up. They would have gone back up 17. So it was a 14-point game.
Yeah, but you're rolling
three
at that
scores.
Point.
You're rolling at that point.
Would
have been a three-score game.
Yeah.
You're rolling at that point.
In the NFC title game, or really in any playoff game, if you have opportunities to change two-score games into three-score games, you have to do it. I don't care what got you there because you went for fourth downs all year long. You have to do it. The level of competition, as Zoe pointed out early, is different at this time of year. You've got to adjust. You cannot treat the San Francisco 49ers the way you did the Chicago Bears.
You can't
do that.
Analytics go out the window here. You've got to be able to feel your team. You could feel the momentum just swinging that game. Olsen even talked about it.
But he gets all the credit in the world. If he catches that ball on fourth down and doesn't give the 49ers a chance to come back.
But he didn't. So that it goes to the decision to choose that play.
I get you. I just thought that it was the right play.
I get what you're saying, but hindsight's 20/20. In the moment, I think it's bananas that he was going for it. I was actually texting Hardy when it looked like he might go for it at the end of the first half. And I said, is he serious thinking about going for this here?
And I texted you guys. What the F?
And he obviously had a moment of wisdom and decided to kick the field goal at the end of that first half, which is what he should have been doing. But I thought he was going to lose his mind and go for it there, too. Was that enough talk about one of the championship games for the call? I mean,
I hope so. Like, if he wants to program it, yeah.
I am disappointed that the better quarterback didn't win the game in the NFC. Because I was ready to come on in here today and start peacocking and yelling about how the best quarterbacks made it to the Super Bowl. Because I don't find anything about Brock Purdy really all that impressive. I think everyone's talking themselves into liking Brock Purdy.
He made a couple throws in the second half that were on the money. sideline throws.
Well, he's a quarterback in the NFL. I hope he can make some
throws.
That one on the sideline with the tippy toe? That was
good. Oh, my God. The way he got the, shoulder square.
Yep.
That was nice.
Ducked out of the pressure, got the shoulder square, and threw the Usyk.
There's the other one where he kind of threw it up in the air cross body, and the guy makes the one-hand catch. He's got moves in the pocket, man. He's got
moves like Jagger.
No.
Yeah.
Come on.
See what you did now? See what you did? Other big news of the day, the Kansas City Chiefs are going to the Super Bowl. They dominate the AFC, and everyone should chase them.
Can we talk about Lamar, too?
Sure, we can talk about Lamar. I also would ask the question, what should the Patriots be doing about the Kansas City Chiefs problem that they and every other team in the AFC has on their hands? What are they supposed to do now? Are they supposed to just sit idly by like everyone else did in the AFC for the Patriots for two decades? What do they got to do? But let's get to your Lamar point. Yeah? We'll do it next. Stick around.
All right.
This is the show that keeps Boston sports fans working.
Yeah, I'm a sexual freak.
Zolak and Bertrand.
That's stuff we do.
On the Sports Hub.
I mean, we mad. Like, I understand, you know, coach going to give a speech. You know, that's his job. But we mad. You know, we got the disposition. One game away from the Super Bowl that we all, what I've been talking about, my team been talking about all season. And we fell short. And like I said, offense, we didn't put nothing on the board. We scored once. That's not like us, you know. We drove the ball down the field. That's cool, but we got to put points on the board. But I feel like my team just angry, you know. Not frustrated, we just angry because we know how hard we worked to get here.
Lamar Jackson and the Ravens have been grounded. They're not going to make it to Vegas this time around. Maybe next time. Maybe never. Will the Ravens ever break through? Everything was lined up for them. Everything.
I took the cheese.
Number one seed, playing at home, a down year for the Chiefs. None of it mattered. Ravens?
Choking dogs.
1A game. Congrats, Ravens. Congrats.
Other than that unbelievable play that Lamar made with Flowers to not to score at seven to counter the Chiefs' opening drive after they opened the game with a three and out, I thought he had no feel for the whole game. He looked lost to me. There was indecision in the formation. He's looking at the sideline. You know, they're trying to relay information to him. He looked one way, came back the other, just sort of fidgety. How about the interception, the Lively down the middle of the field? Triple coverage. I know there's contact. Yeah, the ball's thrown 5 yards short.
You're saying it's a meltdown?
He melted down. He couldn't elevate in the biggest game. They've never hosted an AFC title game at home.
Biggest game of his career.
Biggest game of his career. Where he's going to win probably the MVP. And he choked. He didn't try to get the ball to Beckham, get him going. Like, he needed those guys.
It was too late. They did the last drive. They tried to.
And it just, they panicked. I thought they had an awful game plan. They didn't use the tight ends. What'd you activate Andrews for? You didn't even use him.
No, their biggest problem, they didn't run the ball.
They got away from it.
I looked it up. Gus Edwards had three rushes.
They were throwing on third and one, Joe. That team should never throw on third and one. See what they did on fourth and one at the beginning of the game?
The Chiefs were 28th in the league in rushing defense and gave up, over 100 a week ago.
Yeah.
Todd Monken.
What's their strength? Coverage. They got an all-world safety. Two good corners. Their coverage is phenomenal. That's why their defense is good. That's why Spagnuolo is able to do the things he can do. They could cover.
Just real quick, I mentioned earlier maybe why Belichick doesn't have a job anymore because the league's gone defensive. But if you look at what Baltimore did, Todd Monken came in from Georgia, literally turned that team around into a running where Lamar is going to win the MVP. Well, the other side of it, Ben Johnson's been the hottest name, and both of them choked this weekend. And I know Campbell's going to get most of the heat, obviously, for the Lions' loss, but Todd Monken, he had a hell of a year. He really did.
Ben Johnson's team also put up 30-plus points on the road against San Francisco. True.
And
so let's not make it.
Ben Johnson didn't fumble the ball.
Day.
Ben Johnson didn't drop the ball.
You know? Yeah. I'm just bringing up the fact that both of these guys changed their teams this year and couldn't do enough to get them into the Super Bowl. While Shanahan and Reid are there. inconsistent and sprinkled all around the league.
Yeah.
Oh, here comes the Shanahan ball washing for 2 weeks.
And I just thought this was Lamar's year.
It's never his year. He has two playoff wins. You know who he's beaten in the playoffs?
I'm not going to take it anymore. I'm not going to take the cheese anymore.
So he's 2-4 now in the playoffs with a win over the Tennessee Titans. Okay.
Yep.
Which was the 2020 COVID season in the playoffs. He beat the Titans in the wild card round and he beat the Houston Texans in the divisional round this year. Those are his two wins. And in that Tennessee win, he didn't throw a touchdown. Yeah. He didn't throw a touchdown in that game.
Was that the Matt Judon breakout game? He just crushed Tennessee? Single-handedly destroyed them? I think that's where Judon had that massive game.
Five sacks for Lamar in that game.
Yeah.
Those are his two wins.
I was shocked how poor he
Maybe he's just not a winner. Maybe that franchise is not a winning franchise.
It's sadly for him, he's not a passer tag follows him now and gets that going again. Where you saw him go to San Francisco and just absolutely light them up. And he had no feel for the game yesterday. Nothing. At home. Rested. Home field advantage. Your crowd's rocking. It's a team that feeds off it, plays out in front, loves their crowd. Nothing. No smash mouth. No running game. Even when he took off, he looked confused when to take off. And they were still in striking distance in that game. All you had to do was have one good series. One good series there in the middle, and you're right back in that game. That game was a one-score game all day.
And again, in the losses that he suffered in the playoffs, I know we've gone over this before. Here are the point totals for Lamar Jackson's offense in the four playoff losses he has. 12, 3, 17. And 10 yesterday.
Wow.
Not exactly potent when it matters most.
Trip to the Super Bowl.
Not built for January.
And they would have been favored because of how they handled San Francisco.
Yeah.
They would have been the favorite in the Super Bowl because of how they went to San Francisco and kicked their ass on Christmas Day.
They had all lined up for them as the number one seed. You thought this will be the year they finally break through. Lamar breaks through. Nope. You have to start. If you didn't already, you've got to start looking at him differently than you did. Yeah, give him the MVP award. Have at it. Congratulations.
Mahomes, say, go ahead. Give it to him. I'll take the Super Bowl.
I'll be fine. I'm going to go try and win my third Super Bowl now. Thank you.
Yeah.
The MVP award will look nice on the shelf. Oh, I'm so happy the Ravens are up.
A turn for him, man. Turned badly for him. Awful day.
You got to fight for your right.
So luckily for me,
back, baby.
Luckily for me, I went over to the NFC game, and this happened again yesterday. This happened. That wasn't from the Super Bowl.
No, that's a new one. He did it again.
That's a new one.
He did it again.
Yeah.
That's his thing. I mean, he didn't come up with the line, but, you know, that is his thing now.
Yeah.
To shout that.
Well, you do have to fight. Like, you think, hey, I really want to party today or something. Like, you got to fight for that right to do that.
Without a doubt.
Because it's just not given to you. You got to take it.
It's not as good as the Patriots bad boys or anything like that, but.
A little shoulder shrug, yeah.
That's what we get, you know. Yeah.
George in Malden, what's up, George?
Hi, I've been on this phone a long time.
Sorry, George. I'm going to say this.
I can't imagine that I've been on this time because you pick and choose who you want to talk to. Now I'm going to say what I have to say. And this is, it should not be allowed for you to pick and choose who you want to talk to. You should pick the callers that come in line, not who you want to talk to.
So you think you think we should handle this more like a delicatessen?
No, I'm saying.
No, like when you punch the ticket.
The callers who call in are waiting to be heard. And he picks and chooses who he wants to call, talk to.
Who's he?
Well, I wouldn't be on this phone for an hour and a half or 2 hours waiting for to be heard.
So this is a personal attack then.
Wait, did you hang up on him?
I'm done with it.
Oh.
Come on. That's the second time today. The second
Milliken
time.
Milliken dumped. I wouldn't have done that.
He got a whole minute of complaining.
You know, at night we go longest order of wait.
Were you too? I mean, we got to look at the board. Everyone's been waiting like an hour.
You do an excellent job, sir.
I thought, George, I said delicatessen. You push the button, the ticket comes out, and you go online.
I've said on my show, if Scott and Rentham calls in, he goes right to the top.
They love it.
There's a few people that go right to the top.
I don't even do that.
If Beadle and Hanover calls in, right to the top.
I don't even do that. Generally speaking.
You do a fine job, Beadle. I know you go in the order of weight.
George, I did not hang up on George.
What did
he
have to say?
You gave the people what they wanted. Milliken, someone asked for more championship weekend talk. You got it. Now we're complaining about the calls?
Yeah.
Come on.
Yeah.
Now you're attacking Milliken. Milliken took a person.
Yeah. Thank you.
George, I'm sorry that Tyler Milliken.
This is on Biff's first day, too.
Hung up on you like that.
Biff's lining up the calls in there.
I find that unacceptable what Tyler Milliken did. I'm very sorry that I'm appreciative of how long you waited on the line.
I stood up for you, Beadle.
I appreciate you, George. Milliken does not.
See you later.
Dumped him. I can't believe he dumped him. He can air his complaint. I was not offended by his complaint.
He got a minute. More than most.
I was curious what his take was that he had waited. He claims he did not wait 2 hours. But it was over an hour. It definitely was. I was curious what take he had that was very important that he could not hang up. He felt it was important enough to get it in. Dave is in New Hampshire today. Good afternoon, Dave. Excuse me.
Yeah, hi, guys. I won't be George. I'm calling in because I think Beadle has what I call BDS. You've heard of TDS, Trump Derangement Syndrome. I think he has Belichick Derangement Syndrome. So, you know, I've been a longtime Patriot fan. Grew up a Giant fan in Connecticut. Moved out to the Midwest or went to college in the Midwest and became a Bears fan in the mid-70s when they drafted Peyton. And been a Patriots fan since I moved back east, you know, back in the late 80s, early 90s. And Belichick was the best thing that ever happened to this franchise, for sure. And to have him, and we all know the last few years haven't been great, but he's, you know, to say he's lost his fastball, and to say that, you know, the league's passed him by is silly.
I didn't say it has. I didn't say it passed him by. Those are not my words. I know plenty of people have said that. Ryan Clark, chief among them. I still think Bill can coach a team. As long as you don't let him touch your offense, yeah, you can coach your team. Just don't let him touch the offense. And I think that's probably what got in the way for him in Atlanta. He got beat out by a guy for the job who had a better plan and better people to coach an offense, and Bill doesn't have those people in his camp right now.
Is there a young mind that Belichick could consider as maybe his offensive coordinator? Like, would Cliff Kingsbury be someone that maybe teams would be interested in? Because I think that's what Bill needs.
So.
He needs to associate himself with a young mind.
Absolutely. That would give him a better chance of landing a gig. So...
Is there any other names Bill's worked with?
This is where we are going to disagree. That, you know, Bill was the best thing to ever happen to the Patriots. Yeah, he's kind of the second best thing to ever happen to the Patriots. The best thing was Brady. The second best thing was Bill, because it was a partnership, and I don't think the success happens without the two of them. So I think you got to factor in both of those things. Landing on Tom Brady in the sixth round was hitting the Powerball, and they did. The one in a million shot. They hit it. But I don't know if he's noticed, but Bill for the last 4 years has not put this team and franchise in a good position. So if I sound bitter about the last 4 years, I am. And if I sound bitter about having to hear about how great Bill is and how he shouldn't ever be fired, like we did for the last 6 months from plenty of people, not everyone, I think it's split 50-50-ish. Yeah, I kind of get tired of it. And now he's gone. So if you're that mad about if you're mad about my BDS, Bill or Belichick Derangement Syndrome, you should call Robert Kraft at One Patriot Place. Call the switchboard there, and you better let him know about this too, because he was ready to say sayonara. Get out. I don't want you running my football team anymore.
Football team's in bad shape.
The football team's in bad, bad shape. It's on life support from a football standpoint right now, and they have no plan in place yet for their offense. None. And if Bill were here, they wouldn't have a plan either.
And your
They'd
former
still
coordinator,
be stuck.
Your former coordinator bolted to go coach back in college because he wants a better offense. Saying something.
Either.
And your
They'd
former
still
coordinator,
be stuck.
Your former coordinator bolted to go coach back in college because he wants a better offense. Saying something.
Now,
look at all of this.
Zolak and Bertrand on 98.5 The Sports Zone.
I have a question. What's up with the Journey in San Francisco? Are they from there? I guess they played halftime and he just kept blaring Journey music at the end of the game. You can hear it in the background over everything. What's the Journey attachment with San Francisco?
Yeah, formed in San Francisco, 1973.
Okay.
Wow.
But like, Steve Perry didn't show up and sing. It's still like, it's fake Journey. Yeah. What'd you take, Taylor Swift or Journey? It's not even, you can't even do it because they're not even together.
Yeah, that's not really,
it's not even a real thing.
A great thing.
Like Eminem would have been head to head with her.
It's,
you know?
Taylor Swift.
Yeah.
Yeah, I mean, way more hits, more.
Oh, God, she's great.
Yeah.
She's great.
Relevant, new.
She's great, great entertainer.
The people are split on Milliken hanging up on George.
Oh.
Dylan said, promote Milliken right now, give him a raise. And then he said some not so nice things about George. I'm not going to read those.
You can. Go ahead.
No, not doing that. Nick writes, I was being entertained by that moron. And then Tyler ruined a good thing. I like that. He calls both George a moron and then you an idiot for dumping him.
I kind
he
of
said
agree
you should Milliken should never be able to dump anyone again. Normally, I hate his Red Sox takes. Now I hate his instincts as a producer. You don't ruin a good thing like that because you don't like being criticized. That's half the fun. Maturity is severely lacking with that kid, and it has altered your broadcast. I'm with you, Nick. It has.
If I saw him yesterday, I'd have punched him right in the head. He was tweeting out Red Sox like videos during the NFC title game, like right in the middle of it, dead smack in the middle.
Pat Mahomes, former Red Sox. No.
Scott says Milliken was absolutely right to dump that guy. I cannot stand when people call, get on the air, and then complain about how long they waited. The ego on those callers to do that, it's brutal.
What would a T-Bone, what would he have done?
Would T-Bone would have hung up on him in 10 seconds.
I gave him way more run. You got at least 30
more seconds.
You probably
did, but I think both of you guys are too protective of the show. Just let him, let it rip. We're allowed to get ripped.
Blame him. I'm from his coaching tree.
Tyler Campbell says, after Milliken hung up on the devoted caller, I figured it's a good time for Zoe to mess with Milliken. And then he drops, I'm very disappointed in this Tyler Campbell email, frequent emailer Tyler Campbell. I'm very disappointed in this email.
I can tell you what it says.
Because if Tyler Campbell, that is, was as devoted to this program as he claims to, and I believe he has been maybe in the past, he would know that what Milliken said on the latest Carrabba's pod, he had already said on this show weeks ago. He says in the latest Carrabba's pod, Milliken states he consumes around 6,000 to 8,000 calories every Saturday, 8 to 9 sodas, chicken fingers and nuggets cold for breakfast, and doesn't like traditional breakfast foods, which I find to be a character flaw of Milliken's. As much as I love you, the not loving breakfast foods to me is a problem.
I like a good flapjack. Anything else? No, thank you.
Yeah, you when you go to a nice place and you get a fantastic Eggs Benedict, there's nothing better.
I've never had it.
A hash? Oh, my God.
Just for context, though, I don't just do that on Saturday for fun. I eat healthy every other day of the week so I can do that on Saturday. So there is a, you know,
how's that going? That I'm how's that working out?
He takes good. Cheat day to the max is what he does.
You can only gain He's so proud. Much weight in 24 hours. It's a fact. I'm willing to max that out as far as I possibly
is
can.
Is that science, by the way? Is that a real thing?
So you gorge, then you fast. Then you gorge, then you fast.
That's it. I gorge once a week. I'm basically fasting one meal a day every other day.
Huh. Can you eat a whole pizza?
Is there truth in that?
I read it somewhere. I'm a big Cape Cod pizza guy in the morning. That's what I start my day with. Pizza.
So, like, does it matter what size you are? Like, could I gain 5 pounds in a day? Or is there a limit?
I have gained 5 in a day. So, I mean, I think it can be done.
I do it every week.
You asked him if he could eat a whole
pizza. Joe and I are sort of experts in this field.
Oh, yeah.
You know, well, losing and gaining weight our whole lives.
Oh, I can eat. There's no doubt I can eat. I can never eat a whole pizza.
Yeah, there's certain things I can't do. I can't eat and then do something because my belly will be out. Like, it gross. It's just, you know, if we got a wedding or something to go to, Zoe, I'm not going to eat large before the wedding because that suit's going to be, that Mr. Sid's going to be, might have to get that resized. You know what I mean?
There's not too much material in there once they start cutting it away. Can't add it. You could always take it away. Just can't add it.
Yeah. But yes, how many pizzas could you eat, you think, Tyler?
Well, these are like bar-style pizzas, so it's definitely nothing.
Yeah, I mean, I'll do two town spas like it's nothing.
Are you getting the Cape Cod pizzas from Cape Cod Pizza in Brockton?
Yes, I ordered them the night before. Well, you can't get them in the morning. I'm an early riser.
So you're eating breakfast pizzas, but not what people would call a breakfast. You can order like a breakfast pizza in a restaurant. You know, it has a breakfast theme to it. You're just eating pizza as breakfast.
Yes, onion, pepper, pepperoni with some buffalo tenders.
It's unbelievable.
First thing I do when I wake up, I grab one of the cold tenders.
And you eat the pizza cold as well?
No, I heat the pizza.
How do you heat it?
Microwave.
Love that.
I want to try the air fryer way. I've never done it.
The air fryer or try the grill?
Here I am with a bullet trying to make these shakes in the morning with protein-infused whey protein so my kid could pack on weight. I'm forcing that down, but then there's Milliken eating pizza.
Yeah, but that's like the good kind of weight. That's protein. That's building muscle. That's
up to 218.
Just carb loading on Saturdays. 218. Milliken, you should start running marathons on Sundays.
I'm good every other day of the week. Small portions, no soda at all, so that's why I'm putting 8
or 9
down.
When's the last time you ran down the hallway?
Have a bowl of pasta while you're at it for the hell of it.
That's the chicken parm. Usually that's my night meal.
That's the night meal.
Remember when the station went off air and he ran down, you could feel the floor shake because it's like a jab right. Jab left, jab right. He doesn't run in a straight line. It's right, left.
I'm explosive.
Right. Your power push. It's almost like a speed skater. What's the odds T-Bone's back tomorrow?
I'm gonna guess no.
Oof, oral surgery is nothing.
Well, we don't know we don't know if he's having any surgery.
If he's got a pus pocket, that'd be awesome. I've popped those with like a Exacto knife.
Zoe's had an abscess tooth and he popped it.
I got dry.
And didn't go
it just oozed everywhere.
I got dry socket once.
Ooh, that's bad.
Not good. Not good at all.
Was that
my face was numb.
Was it a wisdom tooth extraction?
Yes, it was an extraction of a wisdom tooth.
Yeah, that's not good.
And you can't like smoke or drink out of a straw or other things.
You do a lot of smoking?
Well, you can't smoke. Because the smoke can't go in your teeth.
You can't suck on things.
You can't, right? Exactly.
Yeah.
Yeah.
That takes you can't a lot of things off the board for you. Yeah.
All right. Well, with that being the case, we got some calls, Milliken. We should take those. The people have been waiting. We'll get to that next.
Myth.
Today, Americans of every age are in need of
Discazola. Mike Bertrand.
Essential part of community life.
Sports Zone.
Just a small town girl, living in a lonely world. She took the midnight train going anywhere. Just a city boy, born and raised in South Detroit. He took the midnight train.
Born and raised in South Detroit. It's a shot at Detroit. Even though there is no South Detroit. It's a good jam. It's a good jam. Good rally song. playing this in the Super Bowl and the confetti's falling if they win. Cha-cha-cha-cha. A singer in a smoky room. This holds. This music holds, man.
Even though it's been overplayed.
Yeah, it works. I don't say, like, hey, turn that off.
Update from TMZ 4 minutes ago. Taylor Swift will not perform at the Super Bowl on stage with Usher.
I'm not surprised.
The stage is all Usher's.
No, she'd be there for the game, support her boyfriend.
You know the kind of coordination and legality. Security, that then go you screw everything things. Up. They're not just going to.
It's a zoo.
In right. a different time, maybe. Mm-hmm. If this were 30 years ago, maybe you'd see that happen.
Yeah, I just want to see him dance.
I just don't think there is. I mean, that halftime show is probably already meticulously planned, choreographed, timed. So he's been working
for a while.
Yeah. Yeah.
He and Bruno Mars thoroughly entertained.
It's not some, like, you know, willy-nilly operation there. It's right. not Michael Jackson standing up there waiting.
Oh, was that bad, huh? People are yelling, go! Go!
Go, Michael!
Now!
Have you ever seen the NFL Films thing on that?
No.
Guys in the like, truck, the like, production truck, being
doing?
Like,
what's he doing?
Come on, Michael! Michael! Come on!
Like,
what is he
away?
Doing? Yeah. That was at the Rose Bowl, right?
I was there live.
Yeah.
I thought he popped up from the stupid me. I'm there with my dad. I see him pop up on the scoreboard up on the south end zone. And then, boom, he pops out of the stage. I'm like, how did they get him down here so fast? Impersonator.
A stunt double.
Yeah. Like, that was cool. Wow, like David Blaine. Wow.
She gets Zoe's greatest Super Bowl moments as a listicle this.
I think we've done that already. Too, right?
Gotta right. do it again.
Do it again.
We can do it again. Yep.
Tony's in Somerville. Hey, Tony.
Hey, how's it going?
Hey.
Can you hear me?
I hear you fine.
Can you hear me?
Can you hear me?
Good. I can hear you.
Okay.
I thoroughly enjoy your show. I haven't called you in a long
Thank
time.
Thank you. So unlike George, George does not like our show. Yeah.
No. My wife even listens to you.
That's nice.
What's her name?
Listen, Robin.
Robin.
She won't call you, though.
She sounds nice, though.
Do you guys play games at home?
Like, all right, like, Robin.
Yeah, you got a good one there, yeah. Tony.
Do you play like, hey, I'm Batman, you're Robin at home?
No.
Okay.
What we do is we play golf, and I have to admit, she kicks my ass on occasion, you know? So, but anyhow, the reason I called is because... back to this draft thing. Mm-hmm. I like the receiver, Harrison. I'd take him. And I'll tell you why. Because they say that he's the closest thing to Randy Moss since Randy Moss. And what I would do is try and trade back in and either grab Bo Nix or the other kid, the kid from Washington.
Penix.
Penix.
Yeah, his hand span actually measured out 10 inches and 3/8, so he's got big hands, which is good. Well, he already took that measurement.
He's got the hands. I would do that because they're not going to win a Super Bowl, but they sure as hell can be entertaining.
Yeah.
And that's what they need to do. Right now they need to be entertaining. They need to build a team around the quarterback rather than get the quarterback because it'll come. And one other thing they could do is trade for Washington's quarterback. I really like him. He's a tough son of a gun. And you know, he'll throw the ball.
Who, Sam
that's
Howell?
What we need.
Sam
we
Howell?
Need a guy.
The little guy?
Yeah, I like him too.
Okay.
Yeah.
At least Tony makes a good argument, in my mind, for hey, Marvin Harrison.
Came with
he said, they're not going to win a Super Bowl, and I want them to be entertaining.
But I told you. They're not going to compete.
Whereas I say, well, that is nice because it would be nice to have an entertaining team. I don't disagree with you. It'd be really nice again to have a real entertaining team.
You know what else I thought?
But I'm more focused on build that next team, build that next champion.
You know what else I thought watching that San Francisco Detroit game play out?
What
an epic, epic failure for the Cowboys. When you look at it, the teams like Detroit had Tampa at home. They got to play Green Bay last week. Like, these are teams that just got in. Like, Tampa's 9-8. Cowboys, you're sitting there with 12 freaking wins. You're stacked. You had home field, number 2 seed.
Good point.
Like, that should have been them. Like, San Francisco wasn't ready to go at the beginning of that game. Cowboys could have came up and got up like 20 on them.
So I was thinking about this. You're,
it could have been your year, Dallas.
How does Jerry Jones feel today? Like, does
that's what I'm saying. And he stayed with McCarthy through that.
So that's my next question. Like, did somebody maybe fall off that's on a team right now that someone would consider Belichick over? And may I just bring up John Harbaugh for a minute?
Yeah.
Like, he's been with the Ravens for a long time. I don't think he's going to lose his job, but...
Yeah, they're number one seed. He's not losing his job.
He's not going to lose his job. But was there anyone that could lose their job from now until, you know, before the draft, I guess, that would consider Bill Belichick?
Buffalo. That's it. Buffalo Jets, maybe. Jets was brought up again the other day, somewhere I read it. You know, Bert was on that, too. And I know Woody Johnson doubled down and said, hey, Saleh's going to be our coach next year. He's on the record for that. But you have the right to reserve. You reserve the right to change your mind.
I don't think Harbaugh is going to get fired, but I think 2024 next season is make or break for him.
Is he tired? Like, is his deal tired? Meaning his just, program, the way he runs.
He just signed a 3-year extension. I know that. Year one was this year.
No, but I know that. No, but like, can he get at that point, like, say they're not good next year, can he get exhausted by it?
Yeah, can he get Lamar Jackson over the hump? Lamar Jackson's going to have Burrow. But hey, look at his own division. I look at it and say, this was the year for Lamar Jackson. I don't know if he'll go back.
Boy, he had me fooled. Oh. Boy, did I take it. Boy, I'm not taking it anymore.
Buffalo came on strong at the end, but they did not have a great year end to end. Kansas City did not have a great year end to end. Burrow was hurt and out of it, and the Bengals weren't a factor. And Lamar had home field advantage, and they did nothing with it.
I would say.
So, to me, it's next year, you get another shot with John Harbaugh, and if not, they might fire him in a year going into a lame duck year. They might just say, bye, we're done.
Where do they improve, though? Like, Zay Flowers is probably a top receiver, right?
Where do they improve?
Well, Queen's a free agent. Like, Odell's free. Like, they got some free agent issues. Again, just like you mentioned, Detroit. That could have been it for them. Because he's going to lose his offensive coordinator. He's going to lose his defensive coordinator. Aaron Glenn, damn good defensive coordinator. He could be gone. Is Campbell good enough to pick coaches to replace him and run those same systems? And look at the amount of free agents they have.
I'd be concerned.
They got a lot. Detroit's got a lot. And the Pats, impact guys.
Pats just brought in Engstrand, who could be taken over if Johnson leaves, who's under Harbaugh. So I just look at it and say, like, Mahomes is in the way of a lot of other quarterbacks, and I don't know the next quarterback who could knock down that Mahomes wall right now. Is it Josh Allen?
This should have been Lamar's breakthrough year, and he couldn't do it.
But again, Tua couldn't do it. Josh Allen couldn't do it. Lamar Jackson couldn't do it. Is Burrow the guy? Like, I'm just wondering, in the AFC.
Burrow to take down
Mahomes.
Mahomes? Yeah.
Yeah, they didn't fear going in there.
Because he's competed with him before and won.
Yeah.
So, yeah, Burrow is the guy.
And now with Harbaugh going to the Chargers.
I mean, don't you think Burrow's the second best quarterback in the conference?
I do.
Okay. So.
But he's the guy.
He's the guy.
But now,
when healthy,
and I'm curious about Harbaugh and Herbert together. I'd like to see that dynamic.
Yeah, you and I agree. We're both Herbert guys. Zoe is not. He doesn't like Herbert.
Something's off.
Mike is in the car. Hey, Mike. Mike?
Hey, Mike.
Michael! All right, he's not there. Let's go to Mike on the Pike. Another Mike. Mike? That line is frozen. It doesn't work. Sean in Worcester. Sean?
Yeah, hey, how you doing? I just wanted to call and talk about the Super Bowl matchup between, obviously, San Fran and KC. I honestly think it's not so much a matchup that's going to be decided by Purdy and Mahomes. I really think it's going to come down to 49ers rushing attack that they use. It's going to be more McCaffrey versus Mahomes, in my opinion, because as you guys alluded to before, the Chiefs, the 28th ranked defense, they let Josh Cook get 100-plus on them last week. I think Shanahan has a little too much experience now being in the NFC Championship games. He's been to some Super Bowls. He's going to have some better nerve. You've already seen that, I think, in this playoff run. They've come back from being down in deficit, and they've actually managed to break through this year. When in the past you've seen them falter, if they're down after halftime, they don't win. Or if they have no lead in the fourth quarter, they can't seem to figure it out.